Well, we're very pleased to welcome Professor Swaran Singh to our IPGRC seminar series. Professor Singh is the Professor and Chairperson of the Centre for International Politics, Organisation and Disarmament with the School of International Studies at Jawaharlal Nehru University. And his main research focus looks at India, China and India-Pakistan confidence building measures and a number of other interests as well. He's the author of 10 books and monographs and over 100 journal articles. And his topic of discussion today is multilateralizing China-India relations. So thank you, Professor Swaran, for joining us.
Thank you, Priyatna. Thank you, everybody, for sparing time coming in for this discussion. Sometimes when author is introduced or speaker is introduced with 100 journals and others, it looks that he's really old. So let me try and appear to be wise as well, not just not only old. I think it's a sense of satisfaction that scholars from India increasingly draw from the fact that China and of course China-India are becoming an issue of interest across the world. There is a sense that we are now perhaps a little more visible than we were. Second, sense of satisfaction comes from the fact that for a long time, whenever some discussion took place where India was mentioned, it was normally bracketed with Pakistan. And I think that is another sense of satisfaction, that the hyphenation for India has changed over a period of time. It's India-China that is discussed more often now. And it is with that satisfaction that it appears that we are now entering a certain era which is making emerging powers together visible. And so I think it's a happy situation for India and Indian scholars to be able to go and interact with other scholars around the world and see that they have greater interest and greater knowledge on issues of China-India relations and of course specifically of India and China. The proposition that I am making for discussion today is to say that the center of gravity for China-India relations, which are clearly two of the several, and the count can go up to 24 to 27 emerging powers. China and India are definitely the most populous among them, maybe also much better in terms of growth rates. So these are two emerging powers where I notice that the center of gravity of their relationship is shifting from bilateral to multilateral. And that's the proposition that I wish to discuss with you in the next 30 minutes or 40 minutes. What is the normal cycle?
About 40 minutes,
yeah, it's up to you. Teachers have to be told, they go on.
40 minutes.
40 minutes, okay, good. You can also caution me when I'm going over 40 minutes. So that is the big background and the proposition that I mentioned, that it seems to be the core of my lecture today. And very often I tell my students in class, if you close your eyes and imagine all the problems that our world has, all the challenges that we have, you will perhaps not find a single challenge or threat, however you describe it, that any state can today tackle, whether it is developmental challenge or security challenge, on its own. There is no challenge that any state, however powerful, capable, erudite, big, small, no state can resolve its issues anymore just by itself. So much so that most of these issues cannot even be handled, even understood in bilateral frameworks. So increasingly, every state seems to find itself engaged in multilateral deliberations, multilateral formulations, multilateral mechanisms to solve which could be our core national issues. of course, this is a trend which is evolving, and very often all these multilateral deliberations also seems to be circumscribed by bilateral relations. Look at, for example, South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation, SARC. It is the India-Pakistan relations. I was just gesturing towards you. I don't mean relationship here. But India-Pakistan relationship seems to define the larger multilateral deliberations in this whole exercise. But specifically, futuristic issues, when you look at, are all multilateral. Climate change, environment, terrorism, pandemics, people's movements, climate, all that issues that you can think of, they are all actually not even issues that can be handled within Westphalian nation-state framework. For example, pandemics don't stop because there's a customs checkpoint here. They move on with the air. So all futuristic issues, and I think most of existing issues, have solutions which are only multilateral solutions. Now, why multilateralism is becoming an exciting area for me is because I notice that whenever you wish to deal with a problematic issue or problematic actor, it is easier to tackle, handle, interact with that difficult issue or actor in a multilateral framework rather than in a bilateral framework. Smaller states, weaker states, vulnerable states very often are not comfortable in bilateral formulations and bilateral forums. They are more comfortable in multilateral forums. But at the same time, it seems that multilateral forums also make life a little difficult. Multilateral forums very clearly are misfits for any quick solutions. In bilateral relationships, you can come to a quick decision and try and implement it if you're in a hurry. I remember Threshold Test Ban Treaty, one of the major arms control treaties, was arrived at in 3 weeks because they wanted a sort of breakthrough to show the world that they're working together. Normally, arms control treaties take about 2 to 3 decades from the blueprint to the implementation. But sometimes two nations can come together and decide something. This is particularly difficult in multilateralism to evolve consensus. Forget uniformity, never possible. But even consensus is a difficult exercise in multilateral forums. Reason being that even at the surface level, while everybody seems to be committed and excited about multilateralism, it is fundamentally the fallback positions which are bilateral. If multilateralism doesn't deliver, then what is my fallback position? That's bilateral relations. For WTO, for instance, Chinese have to sign bilateral agreements with all the countries to then get into a multilateral framework. So it seems still the fallback position is bilateralism, and bilateralism therefore continues to circumscribe all our formulations of multilateralism over a period of time. Multilateralism also has certain historical baggage. We had great initiatives after First World War, still greater initiatives after Second World War. So we have this whole United Nations system and Bretton Woods institutions, which seem to broadly dominate when we say multilateralism. That is the kind of multilateralism that we notice in international relations. But we also know that almost from 1960s there have been debates on how these institutions and norms that they have produced need to be revisited, restructured, reorganized. And lately, of course, the debate has become far more stronger, again in the context of emerging powers. And it seems that as there is no alternative available, there is no other possibilities, these structures and norms continue. But over a period of time, their credibility has eroded. So it seems particularly the emerging powers virtually give lip service to some of these norms and institutions, but their core national interests are no longer guided or no longer restricted by the fact that they are committed to some of these multilateral organizations or multilateral forums or norms that come out of it. So that to me seems to be the backdrop of decaying, declining, eroding credibility of multilateral, core multilateral conventional mechanisms. And here is a new upsurge of, maybe I'm a little biased, of emerging powers, emerging economies, emerging societies, which is the bigger backdrop, which makes me see that this new large group of, I said, up to 24 to 27 countries, and they want to formulate a new kind of multilateralism over a period of time. And of course, if you look at the world map, it seems Asia is perhaps a little hyperactive on that, that particular platform of multilateralism. And Asia, of course, you know, runs from Australia till Palestine. So it's a large number of countries that are involved, but large amount of new formulations, and one could put physically ASEAN in the center, and of course literally in the center of these debates on multilateralism, of pan-Asian community, pan-Asian initiatives, etc., being tried. That is the formulation which seems to make Asia unusually potent player globally. And in Asia, it seems, other than ASEAN, India and China are visible actors, and therefore formulations that they have are becoming clearly important, because clearly implications of how China and India organize their formulations of multilateralism, how they implement that, has impact not only on their bilateral relationship, where I said center of gravity is shifting, but hopefully they also have impact for regional pan-Asian evolution of multilateralism, and potentially maybe even beyond. I also sometime, maybe a little ambitious formulation I make, I believe that Asian wisdom has to be part of the new global world order if it has to sustain and deliver. It seems 20th century multilateralism and world order has largely been Anglo-Saxon, and therefore repeatedly it falls. I'm told peacekeeping operations, once they sign a ceasefire line, on ceasefire agreement, on average they last only 4 to 5 years. So why should you go and solve issues that you know will not last more than 4 to 5 years? What is the reason? And I think the large chunk of other civilizations, cultures and traditions need to be perhaps co-opted, if not, you know, brought in as equal partners, is where I locate them. Why China and India and their bilateral relations are important in formulating multilateralism, and how multilateralism is formulating their bilateral relations. To give you a couple of examples which show that there is a drift. December last, Prime Minister Vanchia Pao was in Delhi, and Indian Prime Minister Dr. Singh, Manmohan Singh, they were addressing a press conference, and Prime Minister said that even if Chinese Prime Minister had last visited New Delhi in April 2006, and now in December 2010, he had met Hu Jintao and Wenjia Pao 20 times in Vietnam. Same was true of April last year, for example. Indian Foreign Minister paid first official visit as Foreign Minister to China to meet Yang Jiechi. But this was his fifth meeting with Minister Yang. And they were meeting in October again, and they were meeting again in November for East Asian Summit, parlays before the summit in Hanoi, and then they were meeting in Wuhan because Russia, China, India initiative was having discussion. So what I'm saying is, these are examples that show that Indian leaders and Chinese leaders meet each other far more regularly in multilateral forums. And therefore, they have already developed a certain bonhomie, certain chemistry, certain comfort levels before they meet bilaterally. And therefore, by the time they meet in bilateral context, discussing bilateral issues, they have certain equation already built in. And that is a concrete example to see how relationship is really drifting or shifting towards multilateral mechanisms and multilateral formulations. One thing which is very central to both China and India when they look at multilateralism and multilateralization of international relations, including their bilateral relations, is their repeated assertion or commitment for democratization of international relations, both at global level and regional level. Now, what exactly that means could have slight shades of difference, but this is what unites them, that both India and China wish to democratize international relations and global relations And all these emerging powers forums become very, very potent tools for that exercise of democratization of international relations. Lot of experts believe, and these are experts which would include Indian experts, that maybe India has an added responsibility here or added advantage here in this whole exercise of socialization of Chinese power elite. That this rubric of democratization of international relations, if it is repeated several times, will be internalized by Chinese power elite and could perhaps facilitate internal initiatives in China. And how India presents a good example of a country which has not fully developed economically, but has proved herself to be a thriving democracy politically. So how a country need not necessarily go on pursuing economic development, saying that we need to first reach a certain level, and how democracy becomes possibility in a developing large-sized country along with development pursuits. So there is a bit of an added sense of responsibility, pride, advantage, however you put it, which India sees, and that in some ways guides India's participation in several of these, whether it is India, Brazil, South Africa, China is not there, but China, Russia, India, strategic triangle, or BASIC, which is Brazil, South Africa, China and India, or BRICS, for example. So these are various forums where India participates with a sense, and you will notice that in many of these discussions, Cancun would be a good example, whereas other emerging powers begin to differ on certain issues and become vulnerable, China and India have stood together and continue to sort of pursue joint strategies on several of these issues. Now this is a kind of a drift which had slightly occurred before. It's not the first time that is happening. Its formulations are happening now, but some of the practical operational reality had also drifted much earlier, which is in participation of China and India in various ASEAN related forums. ASEAN Regional Forum, for instance, is where in early 1990s, 94-95, India and China had started working together in a multilateral context together. And then, of course, later in East Asian summits, also they worked together. If you go back historically, the region called Indochina was seen as a buffer between India and China. Indic and Cynic civilizations kind of decided that we will not push each other, keep this as a buffer zone. And in modern times, in recent times, therefore, Southeast Asia was seen as a theater where engagement of India and China could get them into difficulties. So this was a test case of how India and China could work in a multilateral context, and would they really push each other too far and get into competition or confrontation. There have been several irritations, there have been issues. For example, China really wanted East Asian Summit first meeting to take place in Beijing, or they never wanted India to be part of East Asian Summits. Now, of course, Russia and United States have also joined. There are irritations, but it seems they have more or less successfully skirted, and I have another favorite formulation of mine, which several people also say the same way. Both of them, it seems, have agreed tacitly to only bark, not bite. So that repeatedly happens in their relationship, but Southeast Asia, series of these multilateral forums tell us that they have been able to handle their relationship much better. If this is the strength, democratization, common thread, and of course this past experience as something that gives them confidence, the biggest limitation of this growing commitment towards multilateralism and the positive spin-off that multilateralism has on bilateral relations has a stumbling block called United States. Now both of them seems to be showing stronger loyalty to United States, if I am using a harsh term here, then loyalty to multilateralism as an idea. Both of them remain to be conscious of not pushing multilateralism so far as to annoy United States. Or vice versa, if you turn the argument upside down, push multilateralism with anticipation of United States looking at these actors and willing to make a concession, so that this noise and hoisting of multilateralism is a little reduced. For instance, when Obama became president in the United States and there was little confusion about tilt towards China, Indian Prime Minister joined in Yekaterinburg in Russia-China-India meeting for the first time. Normally, Prime Minister doesn't attend these meetings. Petroleum Minister used to go. So you show greater interest in multilateral forums which are bringing China, Russia, India together to say, hello, are you looking? So it could be interpreted in both ways, that whether it is a relationship that makes us vulnerable or it makes us more committed towards pursuing a multilateral paradigm over a period of time. Other problem which also has lately emerged, which is a second stumbling block, is that their economic relationship, and I'm talking of China and India, the economic relationship was described for a very long period, and I have done writings on the same subject, as the most agreeable and most reliable pillar of their bilateral rapprochement. That this is what really provides strength to their relationship. Now that has also come under a bit of a cloud. In last 3 to 4 years, bilateral trade, for instance, has continuously gone up. It's about $62 billion last year. It's not a big deal, but it's a big deal because China is the largest trading partner for India now. And India is about 7th largest partner for China. But that pillar is now shakier. From early 1990s, India was a unique country that had balanced trade relationship with China. No other country had balanced trade relationship with China, United States, Japan, Taiwan, any Hong Kong. No country had balanced relationship. The worst examples could be Maldives, where 97.3% was exports from China and 3.1% exports from Maldives to China. Now, completely one-sided. But here in India-China, to come back to my main point, deficit has shot up in last 3 to 4 years. It's estimated to be about $7 billion for first quarter of this year. So estimates are it will cross about $22 billion at end of this year. So if one third of the trade is now the deficit, that shows that we are saturating in terms of continuously growing as economic partners, which was a strength, now it is becoming a limitation. Likewise, we have signed several contracts for potential investments into each other's country, but most of them are held in various bureaucratic processes. So if you look at the contracted value and actual realized value, it's kind of $250 million of China and India, about $1 billion of India and China, but contracted would be about $10 to $12 billion. So it's a huge gap in what is aspired and what is achieved. So that is a kind of a second limitation. And this is happening in face of continuous high growth rates, the fact that we talk about China becoming now the second largest in current dollar terms economy in the world, in PPP terms, India is of course fourth largest, etc., etc. So economies are doing fine, but their bilateral economic relationship is getting into a certain amount of limitation. And remember, it is their economic development that had brought them into engagement with outside world, particularly Chinese, and brought them together into various multilateral forums. It is increasing engagement with outside world that made them meet each other repeatedly, their paths were crossing again and again, and ASEAN had to some extent facilitated that exercise over a period of time. Another limitation that is related to their formulations of multilateralism is that both have had different trajectories. Now, assuming that as part of emerging powers, they are willing to set the stage for an alternative paradigm of multilateralism and gradually provide an alternative to what is Bretton Woods and United Nations structures and that have been dominating all this so far. Their theoretical formulations or their experiences have different trajectories, they have different experiences. India, in this case, had a peaceful transfer of power. We had almost continuation of Westminster system. Very often we joke in India that the British have changed their laws and we still have the older laws being utilized in India. So we have continued with similar systems, and British, of course, were a power which were engaged with the world. They were part of League of Nations, part of United Nations. So India, before we became independent, we were founding members of United Nations. So India had, in terms of continuing British traditions, a strong commitment in multilateralism right from beginning. And multilateralism, this in this case, is different. It's principle and institution and norm-driven multilateralism. Multipolarism is different. Multipolarism is power-driven. So non-aligned movement, for example, which was criticized in the West, was an example of commitment to multilateralism right from day one when India was born. And, you know, it was driven by two norms. One, that India would make sure that it steers clear from all military alliances. It did not mean that we steer clear from other alliances. India was open to other alliances, sports alliances, business alliances, cultural alliances, economic alliances, fine. The norm was restricted to steering clear from military alliances, and even today, as a minority of one in 1.2 plus billion people of India, I can give you a guarantee that India will never be part of any military alliance. So that non-alignment principled multilateralism continues to guide Indian way of life or foreign policy till date. Second norm of that multilateralism was autonomy of foreign policy. In lunch we were discussing, you know, why is India is not very close to any other country. Because of this obsession or preoccupation with autonomy, being independent in foreign policy. Sometimes we have been also paying cost for such exercises. So some of those norm-driven multilateralism is in continuity. So there is little change in India. We are at home with multilateralism. China's experience is more interesting. Because China, if you remember, was not peaceful transfer of power like case of India was. They had a violent revolution. They had a clean slate to rewrite history. But they noticed containment as the biggest challenge. And therefore, all, particularly Western-sponsored, as they were described, multilateralist institutions or norms were seen as against Chinese interests. They were seen as part of containment China. And China did not therefore join any of these multilateralism which were existing at that time, or was not allowed to join in some of them. So it felt pariah to multilateralism as it was born. The only multilateralism that Chinese knew was either the Comintern variety, you were part of the communist bloc, or I think I'm almost tempted to say, we take pride in saying that other than the communist countries, India was a major facilitator of ensuring China gets into multilateralism. And I remember before India became independent in August in 1947, in March and April there was a famous Asian relations conference. So India always saw its destiny with Asia, even from 1937 or 28 Brussels conference of colonies. 1947 March-April conference on Asian relations in Delhi had taken a decision that the next conference will happen in China. China was still struggling for liberation at that time. So this was a kind of a trust between two Asian civilizations to say China should also provide lead for Asian relations. Of course, they were moving towards their revolution and Asian relations conference did not happen. What happened next was Bandung conference of Afro-Asian nations. Again, India did facilitate China coming into Bandung conference. And of course, there are explanations that led to the drift, that led to beginning of the problems in China-India relations. But more interesting than this, now there are documents to prove that in middle of the China-India war of 1962, the permanent representative of India in New York was asking, should he change his tab on supporting China's case for UN Security Council permanent seat? And Nehru said, no. Even in the middle of the war, India was supporting Chinese case for a permanent seat in UN Security Council. So India's commitment to multilateralism is what I'm emphasizing, was natural to us, like the air we breathe. And therefore, all other peer powers must be part of that multilateralism. It is not a favor to China, but our own commitment, the way we looked at the world, guided India's foreign policy to push that China should be part of that kind of multilateralism. But what China did, China had their own limited maneuvering space at that time. So China developed what whole world calls China card. They had the unique capacity to swing, which Indian democracy doesn't swing like that. They could swing from east to west, to west to east, and therefore that became Chinese way of organizing foreign relations. So in 1970, to cut the story short, I don't know how many minutes are gone, how many minutes I have?
10 minutes.
About 10 minutes, good, thank you, you're a nice host. So, to come back to what I'm quickly closing, that long historical story, which most of you should be familiar, I should not have gone that far in that. In 1970, the swing shifted the relationship to United States, and of course, famous story of Nixon visiting. For the first time, an American president was visiting a country with whom it had no diplomatic relations. And there's a very interesting photograph of Nixon shaking hand with Chairman Mao in his library. And Mao is sitting, explanation was his bad health. But Nixon bowing down to shake hand because Mao is sitting on the sofa. So it's a very interesting way relations were opened, and Chinese civilizational pride and other issues are very symbolic in this. But the moment that relationship opened, China started joining in all the so-called indenture. Mao used to call this indenture, joining all these Western multilateral regimes. Gradually, in 1994, they were even part of Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty and MTCR and everything else. More recently, Nuclear Suppliers Group. So China over time has gotten to all these multilateral forums, and the formulation is that they serve good purpose. If United States want to continuously spend $800 billion on defense of the world, and we can focus on resources, that's a smart thing to do. So why not? So over time, the policy has gradually evolved in a very different direction. But to come back to now, contemporary times, where China is part of all multilateral forums, India is part of most multilateral forums. In nuclear context, there is a disjunction because China is part of, starting with Nuclear 5 to Non-Proliferation Treaty and MTCR and everything else. India is, as of now, outside those nuclear non-proliferation forums, but in all other forums, they are together. So there are multilateral forums as we now stand, where two of them work together. There are other multilateral forums where gradually Chinese are not comfortable in allowing or facilitating India's entry into those multilateral forums, which is, I can understand, why should they create space for India, which is another peer Asian large size society, duplicating Chinese in many ways, in international big tables on decision making. So fundamentally now, as we stand, two examples show me that the drift is again occurring, where there is a mutual understanding in facilitating each other's entry into multilateral deliberations. Other than several negative examples which I could give you, for example, India does not want Chinese to be part of BIMSTEC, for example. Or we have a separate Ganga Mekong initiative, and you know, you have separate Mekong navigational initiative from Chinese side. There are areas where we are very sensitive, but areas where we are opening up, and two good examples, robust example of contemporary times is China coming as observer in South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation, and India being given observer status in Shanghai Cooperation Organization. These are two clear examples of really China and India facilitating, and minus these two countries facilitating, that would not have occurred. China was for a long time interested in finding some role in SAARC. Minus India, you couldn't have achieved it. Similarly, in Shanghai Cooperation Organization, Russian leaders were talking of it almost from the time Shanghai 5 became Shanghai Cooperation Organization and Uzbekistan was brought in. Russian president then had said maybe India is another candidate who should be brought in. Nazarbayev has been talking for a long time that India should be brought into SEO. Not possible. Only when China said, yes, India can come in, India comes in. So these are two recent examples to me which show that they can facilitate each other's entry into multilateral forums. There are again few hiccups. For instance, if you notice, I said at some stage United States is a big stumbling block. These last 5 years, India has really developed close relationship with United States. And that has a reflection on how India is facilitating Chinese entry into SAARC and how China is facilitating India's entry into SEO. India's excitement about SEO is normally described as lukewarm. And very often we need to explain why. And we have to repeatedly say, no, it is not because we are close to United States that we are not showing too much interest in Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Chinese, on the other hand, have shown tremendous interest. And they want to take as many initiatives as possible as observer country in SAARC. They invite delegates of 400 youth and 100 politicians, young politicians, and all that kind of activities. Media groups and others keep going and they want to do more programs with SAARC countries. Their trade has gone up with all the SAARC countries. They've become largest investor in Nepal from last year, where India was the largest investor all these years. So all these transformations are occurring and how China is able to utilize a multilateral forum to find a greater space. And even when facilitated, India is not able to find a greater space in case of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. So there is a little difference in enthusiasm of India in accepting facilitation from Chinese because we are getting closer to United States. And there is a certain increase in enthusiasm from Chinese side in engaging South Asian countries because India is facilitating their entry into it. But let me just close by saying there is a drift, but it is, as I'm mentioning, so many multi-drifts within the drift. It's not a clear drift from bilateral to multilateral. The drift itself has a lot of hiccups in between here. The larger canvas shows you, yes, there's a drift. But when you start looking at the drift itself, it has so many minor deviations within how that drift is conceptualized, how that drift is implemented. And that is explained by my last point, is that relationship from 1970s onwards has become increasingly asymmetrical. Until 1970s, one goes back to 1840s, they were almost parallel in terms of development indices. And 1970s onwards, the indices have shown that there's a big gap between how China has evolved and how India has evolved. At least in economic indices, Chinese have really gone far ahead. And a lot of Indian scholars take that with a pinch of salt, like others take with a pinch of salt, because then you talk about social implications, environmental impact, lots of other things that it has resulted in, and that will start showing impact. And there are scholars in India who talk about India being the marathon runner compared to Chinese being a sprinter. These are sometimes self-satisfactory, self-congratulatory formulations. But even in the asymmetry, there are various multiple hiccups and multiple explanations that occur. But big canvas, yes, it is an asymmetric relationship, and that shows that India becomes really increasingly reluctant to be seen as being facilitated by Chinese. Though we have a stronger commitment for multilateralism, I mentioned right from the beginning, and that reluctance sometimes is linked to United States. That since India is getting closer to United States, it would perhaps not mind United States propping India as an emerging great power, but it cannot allow Chinese to have that same sense that they are facilitating India's rise as well. So there is a little disjunction that is beginning to occur in their formulations as to what they mean by multilateralism, how they wish to engage each other in multilateralism, and how will not only their bilateral relationship will move in that multilateral framework, because there are a few stumbling blocks I mentioned, but how will that impact on the larger Asian canvas, where ASEAN is trying to establish pan-ASEAN security community, cultural community, economic community, on which both India and China are perfectly at home. But how will that be realized if there is still disjunction and there is still suspicion that China is fundamentally at home with multipolarism and not multilateralism, and that it is only a transitory position the Chinese hold, and they will fall back to multipolarism once they have sort of reached a certain level of their growth and potency in terms of power. So I'm only presenting to you that the canvas has a bigger canvas, shows a big drift, but there are a lot of chaos and a lot of uncertainties that continue to exist in how that drift will impact and how that drift will evolve their relationship and their regional relationships as well. Let me close here. I think I've almost finished my time. Let me say the last thing. I'm always more comfortable in the second part, because then I know I will be speaking on things at least one of you would be interested in. I hope whatever I said so far was of some interest to some of you in this room. Thank you so much.